touch and check.
Yes.
Noon tour back in building four, so I do have to get this wrapped up by time.
Being taped.
The first hot air balloon rides. There's a rumor that.
Hi, Mary Ellen. Thanks for joining.
19th century, the plant small enough with enough power to. Under roof, 350 aircraft on this, and they were supposed to fly 2 days earlier, but the aircraft got some. But since the Air Force ever flew, the first flight went from the wing to be purchased by any branch of the U.S. military. Now, this is not the original aircraft. It's an industry in London. When our reproduction people are trying to reconstruct aircraft, trying to find someone who can make original fabric is tough. We just finished, it's going to come back on display, a World War I era trainer called the JM4. And they found a mill in England that can still make the fabric to the way it was made back over 100 years ago. And that took some time to get the contract, to get the mill to make the fabric and so forth. Okay.
So did the fabric cover wood?
Yes, it's a wood frame.
Is it working now? I switched
until
to Wi-Fi.
Until you get into really the late 1920s, almost all aircraft are wood frame with fabric covering. Metal is used on some of the cowlings, but not for the main fuselage or the wings. That starts to occur just about 1930.
So this is completely incorrect
in
metal.
Oh, good. Thanks, Mary.
Well, no, some of the metal pieces for the frame would be correct.
So they did use metal.
Yeah, on some of them, on some of the frame pieces, but the basic structure of the wing.
The wings were
wood. Right. And we have an uncovered wing around the.
This place is huge.
See what the inside of the wing was. The original specifications for the very first U.S. military aircraft. It had to be able to be disassembled.
This is one of six buildings.
So they could put it on a wagon and haul to where they need it. It needs to carry two people. It had to stay aloft for one continuous hour. It needed a range of 125 miles. And in still air, it needed to achieve the blinding speed of 40 miles an hour. That was the very first specifications for a U.S. military aircraft.
That is a
It is. Mm-hmm. So we're going to go around the corner. We're going to advance from like 1909, 1910, to the start of World War I in 1914. And what I like to point out is how quickly technology advanced during this roughly 4 to 5 year period. One of the things that I think people find interesting is during this period of time, 1909, 1910, 1914, now we're kind of used to the US as being at the forefront of aviation technology. Back then, that wasn't the case. The Europeans were far ahead of us. Part of it was the Wright brothers got into a patent argument with another early aviator, Glenn Curtiss. And they spent a lot of time in court over who gets to control what patent. Well, over in Europe, they just went ahead and started developing better aircraft. Things happen. So if this is kind of 1909 technology, white aircraft hanging from the ceiling there. That's an Avro, a 504. It's a British design. That's 1913. So there's 4 years difference in design from here to there. And then the aircraft on the ground here is a French design, a SPAD 7, and that's roughly 1916. So 1909, 1913, 1916.
Well, the motors were getting better.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that was probably the big thing.
Well, the big issue was getting the early gasoline engines, getting one light enough with enough horsepower output that they could actually keep the aircraft airborne. The early Wright Flyers actually had to be launched by a catapult. They'd have a rail underneath the aircraft, and they'd have behind it a tower with a big weight. They'd hook up the catapult. When they're ready to launch, they'd fire up the engine, rev it up, drop the weight, and then kind of launch the aircraft off the ramp. And then once it was airborne, the engine could keep it in the air. It was a couple of years, probably about 1910, 10, 19, 11 when they got an engine powerful enough to take them off the ground without the use of the catapult. But in the meantime, over in Europe, they're just charging on ahead of us. So 1914, depending on how your history courses were about World War I, the Guns of August 1914, fighting breaks out in Europe. Starts off between the Austro-Hungarian Empire and Serbia. And in the Balkans, where a lot of tensions continue to this day, and they had this disagreement, and the Austro-Hungarians thought that they could just kind of walk into Serbia and take care of their problem. Well, it spiraled out of control very rapidly. Germany got pulled in. Then there was an alliance between France and Russia. They got pulled into it. The British had an informal agreement. They got sucked into it. Next thing you know, by the fall of 1914, you've got most of the major European powers fighting each other. And on the Western Front, it ended up descending into the trench warfare that basically characterized the Western Front for really almost the whole war. Aircraft were the new element. Initially, aircraft were used for observation. Didn't take too long, though, for opposing pilots to start taking pot shots at each other.
Hi, Dean.
So pistols, rifles, let's mount a machine gun. And then, of course, we thought, well, how about if you mount the machine gun right from the front of the engine cowling? Of course, you can see it's a little problem.
A prop in the way.
The propeller kind of gets in the way of the machine gun. One of the initial efforts was to put kind of metal plating on the propeller. Trouble with that, though, was sometimes the bullets got deflected back toward the pilot, which you could see would make for a rather interesting time if you're the pilot. I think it was the Germans first came up with a system where they had a cam mechanism attached to the main drive shaft. So as the propeller blade sweeps in front, it interrupts the firing circuit. However, secrets like that didn't last very long. And during this period of time, when aircraft got shot down over enemy territory, they hit the ground, you could kind of put them back together again. So both sides quickly figure out what's the other side up to. So if the Germans were first, the British and French quickly figured out what they're up to because of downed aircraft and incorporate their own designs. Now, the United States does not get involved in World War I officially until 1917, but there were several thousand Americans living in France at the start of the war, and many of them joined the French Foreign Legion because they wanted to fight for France. They couldn't join the French Army because they weren't French citizens, so you joined the Foreign Legion, but you're right up here at the French Army. And a handful got involved in flying. It was a group called the Escadrille Lafayette that was all American flyers. There was approximately about 200 Americans ended up flying for the escadrille and a couple of other units. About 70 of them were killed in action. Then once the US enters the war, most of those pilots transferred into the American Flying Corps. But since the United States did not have any frontline aircraft, our pilots basically flew British and French designs, including initially the SPAD 7. And the empty space here is where we're going to be bringing back our JN4, popularly called the Jenny. The most widely built American trainer. And it was under reconstruction for about the last 2 years, including trying to find somebody in the world who could make the original fabric, which, as I said, we found a mill in England that could produce that original cotton muslin. And it's supposed to be coming back on display very shortly.
How many are airworthy? Do you know, Mark?
Say again?
The Jennies. How many are airworthy now?
Today?
Yeah.
I haven't got a clue. I'm sure there's some somewhere.
Yeah.
They were, because after the war, a lot of those were sold off to former military pilots, and that's where the barnstormers came from during
right.
the 1920s. Yeah. For many Americans, the first experience with a actual aircraft up close was a JN4. Any fans of the Peanuts comic strip?
Oh, yes.
Good. Got a trivia question for you. Snoopy imagines himself to be a World War I fighter pilot. And who is he flying against?
The Red Baron,
Baron von Richthofen. Now, von Richthofen is commonly associated with the Fokker triplane. Of course, when he flew his aircraft, it was always painted bright red, thus the Red Baron. Although the Fokker was not the only aircraft he flew. In fact, most of his victories were in other aircraft. During World War I, technical advancement was so rapid that a frontline fighter today would be obsolete by the end of the year. It just advanced that quickly. So there's the Fokker triplane. Now, what plane specifically does Snoopy imagines his dog has to be? Now we'll really find out who's a real... say again? Not a Spad. Not a Spad. He's very specific about it.
A Sopwith camel.
A Sopwith camel. I can have a prize for that. Here's a Sopwith camel. This is a British design. This was about 1917, so it came on about a year after the Spad 7 was frontline.
It's older than the Model T.
This uses a radial engine. The Spad is water cooled like a car, and typically the radiator would be on the underside behind the engine. The other design is the radial, which is air cooled, and there's pluses and minuses to both. With the water cooled, you can operate at a higher temperature, maybe a little more efficient operation, a little more streamlined. The downside, though, is you get a couple bullets into the radiator, and there goes your engine. With the air cooled, you darn near got to put the bullets into the engine itself to kill it. So it's the rush of wind air over the radial that cools it. And you'll see both types of engines being used all through through World War II. And even today, if you look at some propeller-driven aircraft, you'll see a combination of the two still. This gives you a little bit better view of the mounting of the machine guns on front, which makes it a little more visible as to why we need that cam mechanism to keep from shooting the propeller off. Of course, once the pilots start shooting each other, and you're flying over enemy trenches, well, you know, we can drop stuff on them. Which does lead to the development of purpose-built bomber aircraft, which is one we'll take a look at here in a little bit. Last one I wanted to show you before we move along to the bombers is this aircraft here, the Spad 13. This is an advanced version of the one you saw on the other side. A particular note, this was flown by the... Thank you. 94th Fighter Group. And this is the group that Eddie Rickenbacker flew in. And of course, you may have seen the history books, the Uncle Sam's Hat in the Ring. During World War I, the American Flying Corps did not have a unified symbol. Each squadron had its own symbol. It's after World War I that we start to get a unified symbol with a star and a circle and a dot, and you know, it kind of went through its own evolution. The 94th is the longest continuously operating tactical fighter group in the U.S. Air Force. I believe the current 94th is operating out of Langley in Virginia. At least that's the last information they passed along to us. Flying, I think they're flying the F-22 Raptor, which is our top of the line air superiority fighter. Now, before we look at the French. SPAD is an acronym for the French company that built it. Yep. So our next major stop will be a World War I bomber, but before that, I need to show you the world's first cruise missile. The world's first cruise missile, called the Kettering Aerial Torpedo, was developed here in the Dayton area. They did get it to fly, but not until after the war was over. Not terribly sophisticated. It would start the engine up, you'd aim it. Okay, I want targets over there, I'm gonna aim it that way. It would take off, leaving the wheels behind. It would fly for a certain distance. Then the engine would shut down, the wings would fall off, and it fell wherever it happened to be. Shall we say accuracy was questionable? I just find it interesting, though, that in 1917, you're only, what, 14 years after the Wright brothers' first flight, we have unmanned aircraft.
Yeah.
But they did get it to work, just...
Was it radio operated
No.
or something?
No.
It just fell apart at a certain...
Just had, I got like a timer mechanism, and when the timer was up, you stop the engine, the wings fall off, and it falls wherever it happened to be.
It's point and shoot.
Hopefully somewhere roughly where you wanted it to go. Well, that was a little
neat looking.
Sophisticated, but the accuracy was probably just about as good. We have a V1 in our World War II collection. So,
that's a big plane. This place is really neat. how long the wingspan is on this aircraft here.
This is the Caproni, the Model 36. This is an Italian design. In World War I, Italy was on the side of Britain, France, and the U.S. A number of American airmen flew with the Italian Air Force after the U.S. entry, and some of these aircraft were brought back to the U.S. after the war, including this one. So this is one is not one of their reproductions. This actually flew. At a point in time, this was state-of-the-art bomber aircraft. It's got three engines, one in each wing, and then there's one in back. And over here, you can kind of see the propeller on the pusher. You had a cage up on top here for a back machine gun. You got a front machine gun here. Oh, those are the fuel tanks. They're not self-sealing either. So you can decide.
Do they catch fire while they're flying?
Of course. And remember, no one's using parachutes back then. Parachutes come into wide use after the war. Oh, the little propeller there drove a generator. This aircraft has landing lights. Oh, there's your, you put the bombs on the rack there, and that's kind of a bomb site. As you get late in the war, particularly 1918, you start to see the beginnings of what in World War II becomes strategic bombing. There were people like Jimmy Doolittle and Hap Arnold and a couple of others, along with some British and French leaders, who started to see the possibility of having masses of bombers escorted by fighters to protect them from the other guy's fighters. And you can see where that's going to lead to as we get into World War II and the mass strategic bombing that became a characteristic of Air Force operations during World War II. So at this point, we're going to go around the corner here. We're going to advance to the 1920s.
So the U.S. produced no planes for World War I?
There was one.
Oh, okay.
The one right there with the white ring and the cowling and the eagle. That's a DH-4. It's a British design. We started building them in the U.S. We built, actually about 800 of those made it over to Europe in 1918. We would call that today kind of a reconnaissance fighter bomber. It definitely was not a dogfighter. But they built a couple thousand, of which about 800 made it over before the armistice. But they weren't there, you know, literally just months before the war ended. What we're asking for about how aircraft were constructed back then was wood frame fabric covering. Here's what a wing looks like.
Our tour group went from three to a bunch.
That was really the construction of aircraft until you get into the 1930s. Now today, if you strip the metal off of a aircraft wing, it would still look kind of like that. Only now the struts are going to be aluminum. Well, following World War I, the U.S. rapidly demobilizes and defense spending drops like a rock. There is, though, some continuing development work.
There's a Model T.
One of the leading American commanders in the Air Corps was a gentleman named Billy Mitchell. And when he came out of World War I, he, along with some people like Doolittle and Hap Arnold, were advocating for what is the use of aircraft going to look like in future wars on the assumption that there would, unfortunately, be a future war. This is the Martin MB2. It looks like a grown-up version of the Caproni we just saw. Got much larger engines, better bomb capacity, and so forth. In 1921-22, this aircraft was used to demonstrate that aircraft could sink battleships. Billy Mitchell was a strong proponent of this. And they went out and they had a couple of obsolete American battleships. There were a couple that were captured from the Germans. And they went out and used this kind of aircraft to sink them, including dropping a bomb in the water.
This is Dayton, Ohio.
The Army and Navy had kind of an agreement back then.
By Wright-Patterson Air Force Base.
The Army was responsible out to about 20 miles, the range of a long-range cannon, and beyond 20 miles belonged to the Navy, and aircraft just didn't fit into this picture. Billy Mitchell was a zealot.
Thanks for stopping by.
He did did not tolerate people who just didn't,
how's your game today?
Didn't see what he saw. So if you did not agree with him, he'd basically call you an idiot. He got himself court-martialed for insubordination. Actually, I think he got court-martialed twice. He ended up getting pushed out of the Air Corps. That's after, though, he organized in 1922 the first successful around-the-world flight. They had four specially built aircraft by Douglas Aircraft out in California. They went from California to Alaska, across the Aleutian to Japan, across Southeast Asia, through India, the Middle East, up through Western Europe, eventually across the North Atlantic, Iceland, Greenland. Of the four aircraft, two made the whole trip. Although they were rebuilt along the way, the Navy had to cooperate. Literally all four of these aircraft were rebuilt at various times. Engines were replaced. Wings sometimes had to be reconstructed. They did not lose a single crew member, even though they had two aircraft that didn't complete, one of which went down in a very remote part of the Aleutians. The crew members actually managed to hike their way out and get back to civilization. Didn't lose a single person. During the around the world flight, Billy Mitchell was in the Pacific, among other things, arranging his island rights. And he did a tour of the Hawaiian Islands and wrote a report saying, you know, Pearl Harbor is going to be a sitting duck for an aerial attack. Of course, the admirals and the ground generals took the report, and he wrote a book in the 1930s about it, which virtually describes what Japan did in 1941. Go figure. To this point, though, aircraft are still basically wood frame fabric covering. Just a little bit of metal sometimes on the cowlings and so forth, but still pretty much wood fabric. Around the corner,
hey, Carlos. Good morning to you.
So this folds so they can put
it
on a train?
The reason to fold is so they get into a hangar. They'll happen to have a really wide hangar. So both wings just rotated back, and then you don't need quite as big a hangar to get into the hangar for maintenance. No, they weren't putting on a train or anything, but that's why they put the hinge on.
Mark, when did they start this museum?
100 years ago.
Really? Wow.
It started originally as a technical museum, mainly open to aeronautical engineers and developers. And then a few years after it opened, they started to let the public tour it. Up till World War II, it's kind of open and closed at various points, but always kind of in this area. It started at McCook Field, which used to be near downtown Dayton. Then they established Patterson Field and Wright Field, which eventually got merged into Wright-Patterson. So the museum was mainly at Wright Field through the 1930s. Then you get into World War II, so because of all the development work being done, they shut the museum down. And as you get to post-World War II is when they start creating the museum as we know it today.
I see.
Okay, this is the P-26 called the P-Shooter. This was the Air Force's first all-metal aircraft. This was about in 1930s that came into operation. It still has some old features. There's an open cockpit, the fixed landing gear, and the external wing struts. But after this, all frontline combat aircraft for the Air Corps are going to be all metal. Oh, it does have two machine guns. Right behind the propellers. So you got the same mechanism to interrupt the firing circuit. Yeah, I just think it's a sharp-looking aircraft. I just like the paint scheme.
It was very sleek-looking.
Yeah. It never saw combat with the U.S. It got replaced, and again, into the late 1930s, it gets replaced by much more modern-looking aircraft, although some of these are being flown by the Philippine Air Force at the time of the Japanese invasion in 1942. Needless to say, this could not stand up to a Japanese Zero. Bombers are also being developed. This is the Martin B-10. This is considered to be the first really modern bomber. It's got retractable landing gear, it's got an internal bomb bay, it's got the beginnings of gun turrets. And while this also did not see combat with U.S. forces, this really leads to the development of the kind of bombers that we see in World War II. There was a point in time in the early to mid-30s when the performance of the bombers was outdoing the fighters. They could fly higher and faster for a period of time. This led to a very unfortunate development of aerial strategy. So as we get into World War II, the thinking among a lot of the leaders of the Air Corps was that the bombers, since they can fly higher and faster than the fighters, will be able to fly over enemy territory, get back to their cities, knock out their centers of industrial production, and the bombers will get through and not have to worry about fighter escorts. They kind of forgot the fact, though, that fighters are being developed that are going to be able to fly higher and faster than the bombers. And this leads to some very unfortunate consequences during the first part of the strategic bombing campaign in World War II, which we will talk about when we get over there. So now we're into the mid to late 1930s, and things are heating up. Over in the Pacific, the Japanese Empire has been expanding. They took over the Korean Peninsula in about 1910. In 1933, they invade Manchuria, set up a puppet government. And then as you get into the later 30s, prior to Pearl Harbor, they start advancing into mainland China, going down mainly through coastal China, getting down toward Shanghai. Over in Germany, of course, you have the rise of Adolf Hitler, and he's got his own thinking about what Germany should be doing. In the U.S., Franklin Roosevelt is looking at these developments, recognizes the threat, but U.S. public opinion prior to Pearl Harbor was, particularly with regard to Europe, if the Europeans want to have another war, let them. And considering what happened after World War I, I think the attitude is quite understandable. Now, President Wilson, as we go into World War I, has his 14 points, none of which really become reality after the war. So you can see where a lot of people are thinking, if the Europeans want to kill each other again, let's just keep, we got our two big oceans, we can hide behind them. Well, Roosevelt recognized that if Hitler's successful in Europe, and the Japanese are successful in the Pacific, we're kind of in the middle. We're not going to be left alone forever. What he was able to get Congress to agree to, among other things, was the first peacetime draft to at least start to strengthen the army. But since the focus would be on coastal defense, the main effort went to rebuilding the Navy, start a naval building program, which became critical after Pearl Harbor, and start to build the Air Corps for coastal defense purposes. So the Air Corps had to go through some gyrations where the B-17, which was one of our key strategic bombers, was originally sold as a coastal defense aircraft. Politics. We needed pilots. The Air Corps training facilities were very minimal at the time, so we started to hire a lot of civilian flight schools to train pilots. Basically, it was kind of like a predecessor to ROTC today, where you'd get trained and you'd be a reserve officer and you could be called up if and when you were needed. Well, that required learning how to fly. And our friend here has a problem. Looks like he nosed in. The tips of the propeller don't look too good right now. Now, what happened? Most aircraft back in this period are tailwheel aircraft. Tailwheels have a couple of interesting characteristics. If you're taxiing on the ground and a wind comes up behind you, because there's no nose wheel, it can flip you. The other issue is when you come in for a landing. Now, as I mentioned a couple of you earlier, when I was stationed in Korea 50 years ago, the air base I was at had a flying club. So I decided, well, come and get a pilot's license. I learned on a Cessna, which had a nose wheel. So my instruction was, when you touch down the runway, once you're down, pull the power back and hit the brakes. Well, if you don't have a nose wheel, you gotta be cautious with the brakes, or you can. Anyhow, I don't know if our friend here is gonna be allowed to go back up. During World War II, the washout rate on pilot training was about 40%. And what I can attest to personally, the hardest part of flying, landing. That's the hardest part of flying. Or they just aren't able to fly the way is needed for a combat aircraft. They might have been able to fly the aircraft, but then they expect certain, you know, abilities, and sometimes. Now, a lot of them end up becoming navigators and bombardiers. So what we'll do now is go across to our World War II gallery. What we are in the process of doing in this first building is replacing the lighting. That's going to be a summer-long project.
It is a little dark in here.
Place will look a lot brighter and different. This is British Hawker Hurricane. This became critical during the Battle of Britain in 1940. Following Germany's invasion of Poland in September 1939, Britain and France declared war on Germany. They had a treaty with Poland. They did not send troops to Poland. They mobilized their forces, and they have kind of this, they call it the phony war for a while, from like fall of 39 to May of 1940, nothing's happening on the Western Front. Until about May 1st, 1940, when Germany decides to invade France by invading through Luxembourg, Belgium, and the Netherlands, all three of whom were officially declared to be neutral, well, that didn't really much matter to Adolf Hitler. They swept around the Maginot Line, cut the British and French forces apart, swept down toward Paris, France collapses, and you probably all read about Dunkirk, where the British do manage to get most of their forces off, although they have to leave the equipment behind. Initially, following the fall of France, Hitler really wasn't interested in continuing to fight Britain. His interest was always Eastern Europe. Just wanted to get France and Britain out of the war. They were eventually going to invade the Soviet Union. That was a given. They want the farmlands and the oil fields. So if he could have convinced the British to sign an armistice, he would have been just as happy with that. The thing is, though, in May 1940, Winston Churchill becomes prime minister. Churchill had warned about Adolf Hitler through all the 1930s. He was not going to do that. So the Germans decided we're going to have to invade the British Isles to force Britain out of the war. The problem with doing that is the English Channel and the Royal Navy. Mm-hmm. In order to neutralize the Royal Navy, they have to achieve air superiority because they don't have a surface fleet that can directly challenge the Royal Navy. So this leads to the Battle of Britain from about July, August of 1940 into the fall, where they attempt to achieve air superiority. You'd think they would. They had three times as many aircraft as did the British. But the British developed the world's first radar-controlled air defense system. They had radar sites all along southern England, and you may have seen some World War I era, World War II era movies, where you got this big map of southern England, they're kind of pushing these markers across the map. They would phone in from the radar station saying, here's where we see the bombers coming in. They put it on the map, and then they have their fighters all scattered across southern England. So you have the alert shack.
I haven't found the aliens yet.
There's our pilot. Of course, it's England. He's having a cup of tea. Waiting for the word.
See the dog
then they
sleeping.
The word, they jump in the aircraft. They could jump the bomber stream.
That didn't work.
How on earth are they jumping our bomber streams? Well, it was the radar. Fortunately, the Germans did not really understand the significance of the radar until well after they had lost the effort to achieve air superiority. Long story short, they did not win. And by the fall of 1940, they're still attacking southern England, but they give up on the idea of invading the British Isles. And in spring of 1941, Hitler turns his attention to the Soviet Union, which was always going to be his primary target. That's a whole other story. So now we'll scoot across to the World War II gallery and the attack on Pearl Harbor.
So this is one of six buildings. The place is massively huge.
Yeah, so if that happens, you start talking and people join, and that's a, or they join, they leave, they whatever, you know.
So your 11:30 tour, is it 11:30?
No, noon.
What tour is that?
Building 4.
Oh, it says 11:30
on the. No, 11:30 is building 2.
Oh, okay.
So we have this one, 11:30 is building 2, noon,
yeah,
building
4. I think
four,
this one's a bigger building than.
Why did the Japanese attack Pearl Harbor? This, of course, gets kind of complicated, as all things political do. While Roosevelt was not going to get Congress to say we need to challenge Japan directly, things he did were like imposing export embargoes. They were getting a lot of oil and scrap steel from the U.S. that was cut off. The U.S. at the time, the Philippines were U.S. territory, along with several islands in the Western Pacific. The Japanese leadership viewed that as a potential threat because we had military forces all through there. So they were thinking, at least some of their thinking was, how do we preclude the U.S. from interfering with our plans to basically take over Southeast Asia and the Western Pacific? And again, what are they looking for? Oil and other natural resources, oil, rubber. You know, the area that's now Indonesia was Dutch East Indies. And they all had oil, rubber, and all kinds of other materials that the Japanese decided that they needed for their industrial base. They decided the thing to do would be to try to knock out the U.S. fleet. Now, one of the other things Roosevelt did was to move the Pacific Fleet from San Diego to Pearl Harbor, which they interpreted to be very threatening. They tasked Admiral Yamamoto to figure out how to do this. Yamamoto had spent time in the U.S. In fact, he attended some classes at Harvard, and he understood American psychology, which his superiors did not. What he tried to explain to them was this: if we attack the U.S., that pacifist attitude about keeping out of the war is going to do a 180 overnight, and they've got an industrial base that will steamroll us in the long run. So if we get into a long, drawn-out war with the U.S., we lose. We don't have the industrial capacity to challenge, and we don't have the manpower to challenge. Well, they overruled them and said, okay, maybe if we can hit the U.S., knock out the fleet in one big swoop, maybe we can force them to the negotiating table, establish an armistice, because we really aren't interested in fighting the U.S. We want to take over the Western Pacific and South. We just want the U.S. to keep out of the way. So they're going to hit Pearl Harbor. Now, why on a Sunday morning? Well, most of the time, the U.S. fleet went back to Pearl Harbor for the weekend. So hitting them on a Sunday morning seemed like a good idea. Now, this is 1941. There's no satellite communication, no internet. You're working on information that, at best, is days old. There was a military attaché attached to the Japanese consulate in Honolulu who was scooping out Pearl Harbor, but he did not have instantaneous communication. While our battleships got pretty much mauled over, we did luck out on that morning. All three of our aircraft carriers were at sea. And one of the main targets on the attack, since they're attacking us with aircraft carriers, was to knock out the carriers. So first lucky piece, the carriers were at sea. The Japanese commander had no idea where they were. So when his aircraft came back from the first strike and said, yeah, we hit the battleships, but the carriers are nowhere to be seen, got no idea where they are. For all he knows, they're at sea right around Hawaii, and they're already launching aircraft looking for his fleet. He was supposed to send in another strike. While he took out the battleships and pretty much chewed up our airfields, the second strike was supposed to hit the above ground fuel storage, which was being moved underground, the repair yards and dry docks, and the submarine base. Well, he called off that strike because I don't know where the American carriers are. If I launch my aircraft and they catch me, I'm a sitting duck. Okay, we didn't know if we're going to withdraw. That was the first lucky thing about the attack on Pearl Harbor. Almost all the battleships were repaired. Pearl Harbor is only about 50 feet deep. So the ships landed on the mud. Except for the Arizona, which took a hit in one of its magazines, and I think the West Virginia, all the rest were refloated and rejoined the war effort over the next couple of years. We did get some aircraft in the air, including Philip Rasmussen, and he did jump into his aircraft in his pajamas. That's not, you know, some, you know, buddy making it look. He was literally jumped out of bed in his pajamas, strapped on the siren button of his plane. He did shoot down one Japanese aircraft. He does survive the war, stays in the Air Force, and retires in the 1960s as a lieutenant colonel. Well, now the U.S. is in the war for sure. Initially, though, things look a little dicey. About two weeks after the Pearl Harbor attack, Winston Churchill comes over to Washington to confer with Roosevelt, and they agree on a Germany first strategy. We're going to knock out Nazi Germany first, Imperial Japan second. However, things on the ground didn't exactly go that way. The initial real threat was still in the Pacific. So, prior to Pearl Harbor, Japan held Korea, Manchuria, and coastal China down to about Shanghai. It also held Formosa. All this other territory in red, they took over in the 3 or 4 months following Pearl Harbor. So they flew through French Indochina, which is today Vietnam. Went across Thailand, took over Burma, which at the time was British territory, and then down through present-day Indonesia, which was then the Dutch East Indies. They invaded the Philippines early 1942. It takes them about 4 or 5 months to drive out or force to capitulation U.S. forces. And as you get to about March of 1942, they control all this territory. Now, the initial threat is, here's Australia, and down about here is New Zealand. So the initial strategy is to have a counterattack would be to build up forces in Australia, eventually heading back north toward the Philippines, as well as launching strikes starting out of Pearl Harbor and coming across the Central Pacific. Well, you can see this becomes kind of a threat, because from here they are launching bombing raids on northern Australia. In May of 1942, Japan sends an invasion fleet down here into the Coral Sea, coming down here through Rabaul and New Britain. They want to take southern New Guinea and Fort Moresby for obvious reasons. They can't go across land-wise because down the center of New Guinea is a mountain range. So going over the mountain range isn't practical. Second piece of luck. The U.S. Naval Intelligence had fundamentally broken the Imperial Navy's code. Couldn't read it word for word, but could read it enough. And they figured out that the Japanese were up to something in early May of 1942. They were sending a fleet down to the Coral Sea. They knew that the target would be southern New Guinea. We send two of our aircraft carriers to meet them. They don't know that our carriers are going to be there. We have the Battle of the Coral Sea. It's the first naval engagement that's strictly carrier-based aircraft. The opposing fleets never see each other. Tactically, it's kind of a trade-off. We lose a carrier, they lose a carrier. Another one of ours gets damaged, a couple of theirs get damaged. The important thing is their invasion fleet turns back. It's their first real strategic setback, where they're not able to take the objective they have to take. A month later, they attack Midway. Now, the reason they want Midway is from Midway they could launch airstrikes against Pearl Harbor. Because, see, Midway is really kind of out in the middle of nowhere. They're going to be stretching their supply chains. Their plan was, we hit Midway, take the island, the U.S. fleet will come out of Pearl Harbor, we'll meet them right here in the middle, and we'll sink the U.S. fleet because we have more carriers, which they did. Except that we knew they were coming because naval intelligence broke the code. So instead of our fleet being here, our fleet was to the northeast. Their carriers came in from the northwest, and we're looking for them. To make a really long story short, on the morning of the battle, which would be about June 4th of 1942, we find them before they find us. And in the course of about a 20 to 30 minute period, Navy dive bombers catch their carrier task force of four carriers, and in the course of like 30 minutes, three of the four carriers are knocked out.
They'd
already launched a strike against Midway,
okay,
the island, but not against, they didn't know our ships were there. The Japanese did send out scout planes just in case. The one scout plane that did find one of our carriers was late getting off due to a mechanical problem, then had radio communications problems. So by the time the commander of the Japanese fleet knows there's at least one American carrier, they're already recovering their aircraft, and now they don't know what they're facing. Do we go back and hit Midway as planned? Should I arm some aircraft to go hunting for this carrier? Are they going to try to find me? And while they're having this discussion, they've got their decks loaded with aircraft, and a group of our dive bombers, almost by accident, at the extreme range of their fuel, finds them. And three out of four carriers are just knocked out in the course of about 30 minutes. Eventually, we get the fourth carrier, though we do lose one of our three carriers. But that ends the Japanese expansion of the Pacific. We are not, though, able to immediately go on the offensive. The first major counterattack is in July of 42 at Guadalcanal. The Japanese are building an airfield and we want it. The U.S. Marines go in and it takes them about 6 months to secure Guadalcanal. During that time, things are rather tenuous because our naval forces are still rather depleted. But as you get to the end of 1942, that's when the Pacific tide really turns to that naval building program Roosevelt started in the late 30s. Those ships finally start coming into the fleet. And that's when things start to turn. Over in Europe, the first major counterattack by American forces is in November of 1942, Operation Torch, with the invasion of North Africa, to kind of catch the Africa Corps between the British 8th Army coming out of Egypt and then American British forces coming across areas like Algeria and Morocco, which leads eventually to, in the summer of 1943, the invasion of Sicily and finally southern Italy, which really gets the U.S. into the ground war in Europe. That's getting away from the Air Corps. Preceding all this, in April of 1942, is the Doolittle Raid on Tokyo. So that's our next stop.
That guy looks happy, doesn't he? Well, that's a big airplane. The displays they have here are really cool. Gee. And here's Reagan's favorite airplane. P-40. He just loves the teeth.
Okay, early in 1942, Roosevelt gets a
secret. And there is the Devil Dog's
we need to be
twin.
Able to hit the Japanese flu miles. Yeah, it's going to be a one-off. We got to show the American people we can hit back. The plan that they came up with is to take the B-25 Mitchell, named for Billy Mitchell, which is a land-based medium bomber, launch it off aircraft carriers, hit the Japanese home islands, which sounds, and this is 1942, this sounds almost impossible. It was actually a Navy captain who came up with the idea. The B-25 is supposed to have a 900-foot takeoff run. Well, on the carrier.
So we have one of these in Georgetown, Texas. It's called the Devil Dog, and it's blue.
They used up the engines.
We see it flying all the time. It sounds so great.
There's going to be about a dozen or so aircraft on the raid.
Actually, I have that.
By Japanese fighters, they were dead. So they took out all the armor, took out almost all the guns. They would have fuel, literally cans of gasoline, all through what would normally be the area where the guns were held. They had a small number of bombs in the bomb bay. This is strictly psychological. Show we can hit back. The plan almost worked. Almost. Escort them to the mid-Pacific. The plan is to launch late in the afternoon, hit the Japanese cities at night, fly on to nationalist-held airfields in China, turn the aircraft over to the Chinese Air Force. Almost worked. The morning of the day they're going to launch the attack, a Japanese patrol ship stumbles on the task force and gets off a radio message. Now, they're not concerned that the message is going to say they're going to attack Tokyo, because they have no way of knowing. Their concern was they now know there's two American carriers in the Central Pacific, and we don't know where the Japanese carriers are. At this point, Japan still has more carriers. The concern was we could be jumped, especially since we can't launch the aircraft from the Hornet because they're stuck on the hangar deck. So Jimmy Doolittle gets together with Admiral Halsey, the task force commander, and decides to launch early, which means they're going to run out of fuel over coastal China, which is in Japanese-held territory. 16 aircraft, 5 men to a crew, so 80 guys, gets together and says, look, what was going to be an almost suicide mission now probably is, if you don't want to go, no one's going to say a word. Well, they all went. Oh, keep this in mind. This is their first combat mission. None of them have been in combat before. What a way to get introduced to combat. Jimmy Doolittle is on the raid, although he was not supposed to be. The senior commanders did not want him going. He kind of did if mom doesn't give me the right answer, I'll ask dad. And he's flying the mission. In fact, that is Jimmy Doolittle getting the first plane off the deck. They go in low across the ocean, and at the time, our symbol's got that red dot in the center. Well, if you're not expecting American aircraft to be flying in from the east over the Pacific Ocean at low altitude and high speed, you can mistake that for the rising sun symbol. As reports that Japanese fishermen waved them on the way in. They hit all their targets. Not one of them is shot down. There's very little any aircraft fire. No Japanese fight because they're not expecting the attack. to hit all their targets. Well, now they got most of them fly to China. One aircraft flies north of Tokyo on its target, so low in fuel it diverts to Vladivostok in Siberia. At the time, the Soviet Union was neutral with regard to the Pacific War, so under the Geneva Convention, they had to inter the crew. It took about a year of conniving between the U.S. government and the Soviet government. They gradually moved them west. Eventually, they put them in a prison camp, just happened to be a couple miles from the Iranian border. And one night, the crew escaped and got across the Iranian border. What about the rest of them? Well, the other 15 aircraft ran out of fuel over coastal China. Most of the crews bailed out. Three of the aircraft attempted crash landings. Of the 75 remaining crew members, three were killed either from the bailout or the crash landings. Now we're down to 72. Of the 72, eight are captured by Japanese forces, of which three are put on trial for war crimes, which violates every rule in the Geneva Convention that are executed. The other five become POWs. Four of the five survived the war. Now we're down to 72, I say 64. The other 64 make it to nationalist-held China and eventually return to the U.S. Most of them just go on to other assignments. There were about six of them that were so badly injured that they could not return to active duty. This is Jimmy Doolittle, and this is co-pilot Dick Cole. Dick was the last surviving member of the Raiders. He died about 2 years ago. He was 101. Let's see now. 1942 plus 75. Okay, in 2017, on the 75th anniversary of the Doolittle Raid, Dick Cole came to the museum. We had a special preview, a documentary about his exploits during the war, and I got to meet Dick Cole, got my picture taken with him, and that was pretty cool. And like a lot of World War II, most World War II vets, he didn't do anything special. What he did after the raid, he stays in what's called the China-Burma-India Theater, and for a year he's flying what we call the hump missions. We're flying transports from northeast India across the Himalayas into China to help keep China in the war, using aircraft that weren't supposed to fly over the Himalayas. He did that for a year. On his off days, he flew bombing missions over Japanese-held Burma. He came back to the U.S. in spring, summer of 1943, gets assigned to an aircraft plant where he's checking out new aircraft, gets married. A buddy of his contacts him and says, hey, they're forming a new unit to go back to theater, meaning China, Burma, India. He becomes one of the first pilots for the very first air commando unit. They go back to eastern India. They fly up over Japanese lines into temporary airfields behind Japanese lines in Burma to bring in British and American troops to attack Japanese supply lines. He did that for a year. He didn't do anything special.
Just okay, a hint of sarcasm.
The main part of our World War II collection. Place by 20 cent improvised models to prevent the secret devices from falling into enemy hands. Doolittle then considered. Talk about all of them, we'd be here all day. And I'm supposed to get you done by 11:30, so.
Yeah, Disney snow. Snow. Not. Those neat engines back there behind the pilot. Big old drive shaft to work the propeller. After this tour is about over, we'll look at the other buildings.
We have like the 15th largest army in the world. Like Romania's got a bigger army. By the end of the war, approximately 15 million Americans, mainly guys 18 to 30, will have served. That's out of a population of about 160 million in 1940.
Good morning to
you. 9% of the population in uniform somewhere. Well, of course, who's going to run the factories? So, of course, Rosie the Riveter. Like, gee, can women handle welders and rivet guns and build ships?
A little heavy airplane back there. The Liberator.
How do we ferry aircraft from the manufacturing plant to the two coasts for embarkation? Was a woman named Jackie Cochran. She was an early woman aviator in the 1930s, kind of a contemporary of Amelia Earhart. And she went to Hap Arnold, commander of the Army Air Corps, and said, I'll tell you what the British do, because they have the same problem. The British have women flying advanced military aircraft from the plants to the airfields. We can do the same thing. And thus was born the WASP, the Women's Air Force Service Pilots. And son of a gun, we see a crew of four women coming off a B-17, which at the time was state-of-the-art combat aircraft. Not going to fly combat, not in World War II, but they did a tremendous job and relieved a lot of male pilots who were sent over to actually fly the combat missions. There's kind of a downside to the story. When they're disbanded after World War II, they are not recognized as full World War II veterans until the Carter administration. Yeah, about 30 years, so it takes a little while to catch up on it. The other major change was the role of African Americans, and of course, U.S. society in 1940s was highly segregated, but we desperately needed pilots. And there was a group down at the Tuskegee Institute in Alabama where they were learning to fly, who wanted to fly and fight in spite of the fact that society was highly segregated and war makes necessity of a lot of things. They became known as the Tuskegee Airmen, and they established a tremendous record during the war. They were assigned to the 15th Air Force in the Mediterranean, flew ground support missions for Allied troops in the Italian campaign, as well as escorted bombers attacking from southern Italy into Austria and central Germany. They gained a reputation for being the best bomber escorts. Now, there was a kind of a mythology about them that they never lost the bomber they escorted. Well, that's not literally true. But their loss rate was significantly lower than most of the other fighter groups, to the point where bomber crews began to prefer the red tails. They painted the tails of their aircraft bright red, which I thought was just kind of an interesting contrast that when your life's on the line, you don't worry about what color somebody's skin is. Can they keep the enemy fighters away from me and get me back to my base alive? Many of them stayed in the Air Corps after the war and became in the 1960s the first general rank African-American officers in the Air Force. The core of the Air Force in World War II, what makes the Air Force is strategic bombing. Particularly in Western Europe, over Nazi-occupied Europe, flying over the front lines to hit the sources of industrial production. If we can knock out the production, we can knock out their ability to wage war. Our two primary heavy bombers were the B-24 Liberator, and up here on the elevated here is the B-17 Flying Fortress. A B-24.
Okay.
Yeah. He was in the Pacific. He was the Olympic star. He got, yeah, and he survived. Yeah. He flew a B-24. The two aircraft are kind of similar. They have 10-man crews, pilot, co-pilot, flight engineer, navigator, bombardier, radio operator, and four gunners. They had a similar bomb load, although depending on which book you read, some will insist the B-24 could fly a little higher, a little faster, a little longer, with a little bigger bomb load. Of course, if you get a B-24 veteran and a B-17 veteran in the same room, they will argue for hours over which aircraft was better. Actually, years back when we still used to get some World War II vets, I heard a couple of them go at it, and I mentioned something to a B-24 vet about the B-17 being more able to take more battle damage. He looked at me and said, well, I won't say literally what he said. He said, I flew 24 missions and I got back from all of them. B-24 is a good aircraft. This is the Memphis Belle. You may have heard of the Memphis Belle before you came here. There's a lot of stories about the Memphis Belle. It was one of the first aircraft to complete 25 combat missions over Nazi-occupied Europe, which raises the question, what was magic about 25 missions? Well, in early, starting in fall of 1942, we start bombing Nazi-occupied Western Europe, France, the Netherlands, Belgium, into Germany. We do not have fighters that have the range to escort the bombers all the way in and out. This is an outcome of the thinking in the 1930s that the bombers will outperform the fighters. Well, that is no longer true. So from fall of 1942 until That flight in was without fighter escort, which meant they were just sitting there with the German fighters swarming all over them. The loss rates early on were horrendous. Some missions, they might lose as many as 30% of their aircraft. So you send out 100 aircraft, 30 don't come back. 10-man crew, 300 dead, wounded, captured, missing. So the commanders decided we got to give the air crews a target, if you will, that if you fly so many missions, you get to go home. Somehow they came up with 25 missions. If you were on an 8th Air Force heavy bomber crew from that period, fall 42 to fall 43, your odds of completing 25 missions was 1 in 4, which meant 3 out of 4, you would not complete 25 missions. You'd be dead, severely wounded, captured, or just plain missing. Now, as you get to fall 43, we finally get the fighters that have the range to escort the bombers all the way in. Things start to change a little bit. The Memphis Belle was one of the first to complete 25 missions. And it came back to the U.S. in May of 1942 on a war bond tour. How the Belle got chosen kind of goes back to a movie producer called Billy Wilder. He was doing a documentary on the air war in Europe, and he ended up calling it the Memphis Belle, the story of the Flying Fortress. So the commanders thought, we better bring the Belle back. So let's go underneath the aircraft. I'll take you on a mission with the 8th Air Force. How are we doing here? Oh, just about right. Just about right. You want to get inside the wall turret? I don't think
I can. Got to be really, really small.
Yeah.
Get out of the way here.
Again, B-17, B-24, similar configuration. In the front area is going to be the pilot and co-pilot on the upper deck. Right behind is going to be the flight engineer. So if you've seen a film from, say, a World War II bomber, that the pilot and co-pilot and the guy standing behind him, flight engineer. This is 1942-43, no automated systems. The flight engineer has got to monitor all the mechanical and electrical systems to make sure things are functioning. Managing where the fuel is, moving the fuel tanks, monitoring the engine performance. Then in the nose would be the bombardier. Then about here would be the radio operator and navigator. Then you got four gunners. You've got the ball turret gunner. Let's see, would anybody, you might fit. Yeah, I couldn't fit. Got the two waist gunners, the guys at the open doorways, and then the tail gunner. The aircraft is not pressurized and not heated. You're operating at about 25 to 30,000 feet where the air temperature is minus 50. And then you got the open doors and the slide of the machine guns blowing in. You're going to be on a mission for about, depending where your target is, you could be in this aircraft for maybe 8-9 hours.
Did you say
20,000 feet? 25 to 30,000 feet.
It's an antenna there that drops down.
Oh, yeah.
Just hangs, dangles from the airplane.
When you go to the second building, on the left side is a cabinet with some flight suits. The third one in from the main hallway is one of those.
So on my channel, there's a video of me flying in one of these, the B-17, the Red Raider. Unfortunately, we lost that airplane
in March of 1944.
In an air show up near Dallas recently. But
it's
I did get a chance to take a ride on it, so you gotta check that out.
The target is a ball bearing plant outside of Berlin. This means flying from southern England into central Germany, hitting target and getting back out. This is going to be something like going to be in this aircraft for about 8 or 9 hours for that whole mission. Starts off, maybe it's around 5 in the morning. You get roused out of bed, have some breakfast, powdered eggs, something they claim is coffee. They show you the mission briefing, and if you've seen these films or movies from World, they got the map with the, that's what they did. There's the, oh God, we're going to Berlin. On this mission, there's going to be about 600 B-17s, about 200 B-24s. First, you got to get in the air. Now, if you've been to the British Isles, especially in, you know, late fall, winter, early spring, it tends to be overcast. You do not have the technology we have today, so when they would take off, they would say to the bomber pilot, go on this heading at this climb rate to get through the clouds, and with luck, you won't collide with another aircraft. Sometimes they did. You get above the cloud deck, now you got to organize the stream of 800 bombers into a stream or a train that's going to stretch over a couple hundred miles and head over the North Sea for the target. They would typically put them into a formation of about a dozen bombers. So the idea was, you'd have three in a V shape kind of leading the group. You'd have a second V down, maybe to the right, and then two kind of up and slightly back. The idea was to maximize the coverage of the guns, so that no matter which direction a German fighter came in, it'd be 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 50 cal machine guns shooting back.
So they'd be their own cover.
Hmm. Yeah, the German pilots called this attacking the hedgehog. Because they would have to level their fighter out to take aim at the bomber, knowing full well that I'm going to be getting shot at by maybe a dozen 50 cals coming back at me. So this wasn't easy for the German fighter pilots either. Now, in this particular mission, the flight engineer in one aircraft, a guy named Chet Pardee. In civilian life, he is a musician. He plays the clarinet and saxophone. He's a flight engineer. One of the waist gunners is a guy named Maurice Wolfram, which the guys all called Wolfie. So they're flying on this mission. He's in this group of 12, and he describes at one point, right before they get to Berlin, that a group of German fighters gets through the American fighter screen. They strafe the box in front of his. They swoop around his box and hit the box in back. One of the B-17s in back gets hit, starts falling out of formation. They start counting parachutes. Command group. They count three parachutes, then the bomber explodes. So you got seven missing in action. But they don't happen to get hit in that particular strike. They make the bomb run. They're flying back now over northern France. They're almost to the English Channel. And they happen to fly across an anti-aircraft battery using the gun behind you, the German 88 millimeter. The aircraft gets hit. Not badly enough that it's going to fall out of the sky, but it gets hit kind of right about over here. Wolfie gets wounded. Chet's up front. He grabs the first aid kit, and he comes across this little catwalk that kind of goes right down the center of the bomb bay to go from the front to the back. I've flown in a B-17. I've walked the catwalk. But see, mm-hmm. Look down, and yeah, there's the ground. So he gets back here. He patches up Wolfie. He finds some broken wires, tapes them together. They fly back to the base, and with wounded on board, they're the first to land. They land. Wolfie gets taken off to the hospital. Now you go to debrief with intelligence. How was the mission? What'd you see? You've been cooped up in this thing for maybe 8 hours getting shot at. You've been up since 5 or 6 in the morning. It's now kind of late afternoon. You've been debriefed. What are you going to do next?
Go to the bar.
Chet's a musician. He's in the bass band. They're having a concert that night. He leaves debrief, runs to the chow hall to get some dinner. He gets to the hangar with the concert just in time for the second set, including a distant cousin of mine. I've got a distant cousin through Maverick on my mother's side, who was a waist gunner in a B-17. He got shot down in August of 1944 over northern France. Didn't get out of the aircraft. Somehow, Graves Registration found his remains, and they interred him at the American Cemetery at Normandy, which I got to visit a few years ago. Oh, well, how are we doing? Oh, we got to finish up the war.
Yeah, that lag may be coming in and out. Hopefully I was flipping screens. May have created that. This tour is almost over, and then we're going to walk all the other buildings. Like I said, there's 6, and the tour is the first 2.
Okay. Look at our fighter aircraft. Okay, we have 3 primary fighters in World War II. The P-38 Lightning with the 2 engines, the P-47 Thunderbolt, and the aircraft right here with the red nose, the P-51 Mustang. It's the Mustang that turned the tide on the air war in Europe. It's got the range and the performance to escort the bombers all the way into central Germany, and it can outperform the German fighters. The main German fighters are the Messerschmitt 109 behind you, with your kind of yellow nose. If you look down this way, you see this one with this kind of a white corkscrew paint on the nose? That's the Falco F 190. It's right below that big aircraft. Down slightly to the right, see the white. Those are the two main German fighters. The P-51 can outperform both. It's when the P-51 comes on in force in late 43 and 44 that we're finally able to establish air superiority over Northern Europe, which becomes essential for the Normandy invasion. And that's when the tide really starts to shift. The orders kind of shift from protecting the bombers to knocking out the German fighters. The task given to the American fighter pilots was, you don't just chase them off, you chase them down and you shoot them down. When we have the invasion of Normandy, we don't want to see a single German aircraft in the air over Normandy. And that just is just about what happened. There was, I don't know, half a dozen maybe that made some strafing runs. That was about it. Probably depends on which history you read. Some books I've read said there were no German aircraft. Only said there was one or two, but it wasn't many. They were pretty much non-existent. So what we will do now is go down to the end, get back to the war in the Pacific. Now the aircraft here to the right with the L-4 is the C-47 Skytrain. Who's watched the miniseries Band of Brothers? This is the aircraft we bring the paratroopers in on. For the Normandy invasion, there's 800 C-47s used to bring in the 82nd Airborne, 101st Airborne, plus British Airborne. Some, of course, would jump. Others were towed in on gliders. And these were used repeatedly, not just in the Europe but in the Pacific.
Gliders up here.
For airborne assault, for general transport, bringing in supplies, taking out wounded. And some of these are still flying. Some of them are still flying.
Oh, Cushman? That's neat.
V1 buzz bomb, which is kind of a first really significant cruise missile. Accuracy was non-existent.
Yeah,
it aimed
fix
in
the gimbal.
Direction where you wanted to go, and basically when it ran out of fuel, it fell wherever it fell. Behind this, the V2.
All right, gimbal. Behave.
Ballistic missile. Again, accuracy was non-existent.
There we go.
Both were used literally as terror weapons to attack southern England. So after the Normandy invasion, for the British Army, one of the first tasks was to push into the Netherlands to push the Germans back far enough to put these two missiles out of range of southern England. Some of them were used to attack Allied forces once we were on the ground in Western Europe, but it wasn't significant. Again, it was more just, it would just fall out of the sky and you didn't know it was coming.
I have to say, this is not a very attractive looking aircraft right here.
They also developed a remote control bomb, radio controlled. When this first appeared, the Allies didn't quite understand how these bombs were suddenly hitting the target. I mean, successfully hitting the target. Eventually, they figured out that the bomb was being guided by the guy in the bomber, so if you shoot the bomber down, the bomb goes off course. Bombing accuracy was questionable. For the U.S. Air Force, we measured accuracy as the percent of bombs hitting within 1,000 feet of the target. Not how many hit the target, how many hit within 1,000 feet. That's a half mile across. Early in the war, it was about 20%. Later, it got to 40%. Not exactly precision bombing. I'm not really sure. Kind of a 20 to 40, not really sure.
This thing looks like a dolphin, doesn't it? There's some kind of fish. These little displays they have here are really cool. Take a look at them in detail after this.
Fortunately, there's always a fortunately here. By the time they got this thing flying, it was late in the war, they produced about 1,200 of them, but could only get about 300 in the air at any one time.
Hey, Don.
They had a couple of issues. That bombing accuracy. Well, where do you not need to be accurate? Oil refineries, they cover acres. Chemical plants, they cover acres. Rail yards, they cover acres. If you knock out the ability to produce fuel and knock out the ability to move it, you can build these things, but you can't fly because there's no fuel. So part of the thing was they didn't have enough fuel to fly these. The second problem was the engine. the compressor section especially, you need very special alloys to withstand the high temperatures. Germany at this point in time did not have access to those alloys. They were using ordinary steel. Consequently, one of these engines would burn out after 25 hours. So every 25 hours, two new engines.
Wow.
As I said, they came in late in the war, could have been more decisive had it appeared a year or so earlier. Sometimes it's just plain luck. So we're going to shift our attention now to the what was going on in the Pacific while everything was going on in Europe. Germany surrenders on May 8, 1945. About was 2.5 weeks after Hitler committed suicide in his bunker in Berlin. In spite of the conspiracy theories that escaped to South America, and they're pretty sure he got himself in. Over in the Pacific, there's two main thrusts. One coming north out of Australia toward the Philippines under General MacArthur, and then from the Central Pacific out of Pearl Harbor under Admiral Nimitz to come into the Central Pacific. One of the key targets as we go in through the Central Pacific is a group of islands in the Central Pacific called the Marianas. Guam, which had been U.S. territory, Saipan, and Tinian. The reason for those islands is, from those islands, the B-29 Super Fortress can make it to Japanese home islands. And we can start doing the strategic bombing to Japan that we were doing in Germany from southern England. We need it the Marianas.
Oh, good.
The Marianas fall in summer of 1944. June 1944. Remember, we got pulled into the war with this 15th largest army in the world. By the time you get to 1944, we've got to be at least 12 million people in uniform all over the world. June 4th, Rome is liberated by American forces. June 6th, the Normandy invasion. And about June 15th, a 1,000-ship invasion fleet bears down the Marianas. At this point, we have something like a dozen fleet carriers, dozens of escort carriers, battleships, cruisers. As part of the battle in and around the Marianas is what's called the Battle of the Philippine Sea. It's the last time the Japanese attempt to launch carrier-based strikes against our fleet. By this time, most of their experienced pilots have been killed in action. The pilots they're putting up are very poorly trained. The U.S. Pacific Submarine Force has been strangling Japan for oil by sinking their tankers. So the amount of training the Japanese pilots get is just enough to know how to get the plane up and down. They're no match for the American naval aviators. The Navy aviators call the Marianas turkey shoot. It's like 24-1 on the loss rate. After that battle, the Japanese are no longer able to launch carrier-based aircraft. And basically, the U.S. Navy at this point can go anywhere it wants, anytime it wants. The Japanese really can't do anything about it any further. Okay, we capture the Marianas, and we start in the fall of 1944 launching the B-29 raids against Japan. As you get into February of 1942, you've all heard of Iwo Jima.
Yep.
Iwo Jima is about halfway between the Marianas and Japan. They've got an airfield where they're sending up fighters harassing our B-29s. We want to take the airfield to, one, get rid of the Japanese fighters and put our own fighters there to escort the bombers into Japan. So when the Marines went in and they were, you know, it took them about a month to secure the island, they were wondering, what are we doing this for? Literally, before they had the island completely secured, a damaged B-29 makes an emergency landing on Iwo Jima while the Marines are still fighting. Now we know why we're getting this island. May of 1945, while Germany is surrendering, we invade Okinawa. Okinawa is going to be the base for the invasion of the Japanese home islands, scheduled for November of 1945. As we got closer to Japan, between the Marianas, the Philippines, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa, we're faced with this mentality of literally fighting to the death. Japanese units did not surrender. You know, as Germany started to collapse, whole divisions would surrender, particularly to the British and the Americans, not to the Soviets. That's a whole other story. But literally, you know, like, let's see, in Iwo Jima, there were about 25,000 Japanese defenders, and maybe 300 were captured. All the rest literally had to be killed, either killed outright or sealed in caves or whatever. And the same thing happened in Okinawa. Then you had the kamikaze attacks. Truman, who's now president, is faced with casualty estimates for invading the home islands. The estimates of casualties start in the couple hundred thousand and go up. And they're imagining that if this fight to the death faction stays in control and gets most of the Japanese population to resist the invasion, this is going to be, I mean, it's going to make the European bloodbath look like nothing. Can we force Japan to surrender? Well, by this time, we've been hitting them with B-29s. Most of their major cities had been burned out. Still seemed that you couldn't break the hold of the fight to the death group. There was a group in the Emperor's cabinet that was saying, we got to stop. They couldn't get leverage to convince the Emperor it's time to quit. Well, in the background.
So this is the one that dropped the bomb on Nagasaki. Enola Gay was the one that...
In the background, we have the Manhattan Project.
Was the first one.
Developing the atomic bomb. And as we come up to the summer of 1945, we think it's going to work. In fact, they're so sure it's going to work that they have two designs. One design, they're so certain it's going to work, was never tested. They put the components together, shipped it to Tinian. The other design, similar to the one with the big yellow, that one they weren't too sure about. So they did do a test blast in New Mexico, Alamogordo, New Mexico, in July of 1945. That darn thing worked. So now we've got two atomic bombs on the island of Tinian. And the question now becomes, what do we do with them? And there is no universal opinion about what to do. Between the scientists, the civilian leadership, the military leadership, there was a amazing amount of discussion about, should we even use it? I mean, one bomb wipes out a city. Of course, we've been taking 300 B-29s and wiping out a city, but one plane, one bomb, should we use it? Should we do a demonstration drop? Eventually, I think Truman, as he looked at these casualty estimates for the invading the home islands, decided we're gonna have to set this up as a raid like any other raid, attack a city, and hopefully if we have two bombs dropped within close succession, the peace faction will get the leverage they need to end the war. We want the Japanese to think that the hundreds of B-29s are now going to carry these things. There won't be a Japan left to invade. So August 6, 1945, the Enola Gay, which is in the Smithsonian, it drops a bomb like the one on the left on Hiroshima. And then 3 days later, August 9th, this aircraft, boxcar, drops a bomb like the one on the right on Nagasaki. And then we wait, because there's no direct communication with anything. And we're waiting. Are they gonna capitulate? A week goes by, and about August 14th, a decision is made to launch a conventional bomb strike against an oil refinery to the northwest of Tokyo. There was one of the flight crew members, a guy named Jim Smith. Got to be a Jim Smith, right? And now they've been waiting for the Japanese to surrender. Nope, we're going to launch this bomb strike. And they're all thinking, am I going to be the last guy to be killed in World War II? They launch a strike. The strike is successful. None of the aircraft are lost. That night, August 14th, August 15th, the Emperor decides we're gonna end this. Finally, he succumbs to the let's quit side, and he makes a recording, literally on a record, that's gonna be broadcast on Japanese radio the next morning. Now, the Japanese people would never have heard his voice before this recording. This is breaking all traditions. Well, the night before the recording's made, there's a group of army officers who want to fight to the death. So violating the orders of the emperor, which is a complete taboo, they invade the imperial palace with the intention of putting the emperor under house arrest and destroying the recording. So they launched the strike on the imperial palace. About the same time, the B-29s with Jim Smith are approaching Tokyo to fly over Tokyo, hit the oil refinery. Japanese radar picks them up. They're convinced they're going to hit Tokyo again. The response is to black out Tokyo, which includes blacking out the Imperial Palace. So these renegade officers are suddenly in the Imperial Palace, which is this labyrinth of rooms, and the lights go out. They do not find the recording. They do not find the Emperor. The next day, loyal troops come in, put down the rebellion, and the broadcast is made, bringing World War II to an end. Oh, all the planes got back. No one was lost in that raid.
Thank you, Don.
He co-authored a book several years ago called, I think it was called The Last Mission, as he was wondering what was going on in Japan while I'm flying over in this last raid. He got with an historian, they co-authored an interesting book which really gets into the detail about what was going on and the internal politics, which just on its own was kind of fascinating. Officially, World War II ends on September 2nd, 1945, on the deck of the USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay, when the Japanese signed the official surrender documents. And that brings to an end the most destructive war in human history. I've read estimates that upwards of 60 million people died as a result of military action, over half of whom were civilians. The Chinese had the worst of it. I've read estimates of 15 million plus, mainly civilians. The Soviet Union was right behind them. I've read estimates of around 10 to 12 million. The U.S., we had about 450,000, almost all military. So relative to the rest of the world, we got off light. And that brings the tour to an end. I'd like to thank you all for coming out this morning. The reason I came here this morning was to lead the tour. I hope you have an enjoyable rest of the day. I am going back to Building 4 and doing the noon tour in Building 4 if anyone would care to follow me. That's Space, Experimental, Global Reach, and Presidential. I'll put in one other pitch. Over 90% of our funding for the museum comes from contributions. We get very little funding from the Air Force. Just enough to pay. We have a small full-time staff, routine maintenance, security, but building buildings, that's all fundraising. Supporting the volunteers like me, that's all fundraising. Educational programs is all fundraising. So we've got kind of receptacles around, you know, contributions. Better yet, become a member of the museum. And the key benefit is supporting the mission of the museum. Plus you get some, there's a quarterly magazine and some other things that go along with it. But again, I'd like to thank you all for having come out. If you care to tour Building 4, I'm hiking back. If you want to catch the Building 2 tour, we can catch them. They just started about 5 minutes ago. If you care to, I'll show you, I'll get you there to get you caught up with them. But have the enjoyable rest of the day, and I want to take a hike.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. Good job. Well done.
Yes.
All right, so that's the first two buildings. Appreciate your time, Mark.
Oh, great job. Thoroughly enjoy it. I'm a history nut.
Yeah, I can tell. I think folks found it very fun and informative.
And I've been immortal.
All right. Just a second. Get back. Please tell me it's working. That's on my shoe. This is a simulator. Alright, set this down. Look at that big old bomber over there. Heather's back. Okay, thanks, Don. Yeah, something between those buildings there, that hallway. Got a little laggy. Well, let me just turn around and say hello. Hello, everyone. Good to see you. Thanks for being here. Yeah, I am in Dayton, Ohio. So let's get back to cruising around here. One of the things I've always wanted to do, they have an Air Force museum down in Robins Air Force Base. And when my dad was stationed there and I was a kid, we lived on base, and I remember the first airplane being parked out where they were going to build it once upon a time. And it's pretty big, but it's not this big, I can tell you that. The amount of stuff here is amazing. I'm glad it looks good. Thanks, Don. It's good to have you here. Look at how thick this airplane is. Like three stories. And we can go in it, so let's do that. All right, stay off the ramp. Well, yeah, I can do that. take stairs to the right. Another simulator. Yeah. Star Tours. Air Force version. Well, Heather is still in Texas. And she gave me updates on what's going on, the weather, how the everything's actually green this year, which is unusual. Our garden doing well. Used around our area to put air conditioners on roofs. The new Costco they're building out by our airport. Had one there the other day. Okay. Watch your head. Not a problem. Am I going the wrong way? Let's see what's coming the other way. Nope, it says enter here. Okay.
I guess we went the wrong way. Nope.
Something. It is tight. Cool. More gauges than I could put my eyes on. Boy, this is when it would pay to be Heather's height, for sure. Tight. Radio room. You always know what this room is. Then the wing would be here, okay. Oh, geez. Smash my glasses. Yeah. All right, that was tight. It's chilly here in Dayton, Ohio, Dawn. It's 36 degrees this morning when I got into the Jeep to get drive out here. Talking about Jeeps. Good old Willys. These displays are really neat, aren't they? All right, what do we have? This is a F-84, yeah, Sabre. Oh, Thunderjet. Called it the wrong thing. The Invader. Big bombing aircraft. There's no way I'm gonna be able to see everything today. Well, those certainly aren't jacks that you want to play with. All right, let's go in that big old airplane up there.
Hello, visitors, and welcome to the National Museum of the United States Air Force. We invite you to join a free guided tour of Building 4, which features a full-size walk-on shuttle exhibit.
Oh, we'll go see the shuttle. There's some presidential aircraft as well here we can take a look at. Now, rumor has it, Heather's been here quite a bit though, with her family, pre-ed. I like that pre-ed. This is, you know how big this place is when you can even put a B-52 bomber in here. All right, so when it stairs to the right, that's up here. We can just go.
Oh, it probably does.
is up there. Yeah, how do you get to the flight deck? Oh, the ladder over here. Yep. Auxiliary ladder to the flight deck, says it right there. This is steep. Hello. Okay, there we go. Ah, it's lagging. How about now? Oh, there's a queue to get annual passes? I didn't hear about that. It's back? Okay, good. I'm not surprised. There's a queue for everything at Disney, right? So that doesn't surprise me. Man, this is cool looking. Yeah, thin that leading edge of the wing is. You practically catch you. So that's the F-22. Yeah, this is really, really neat stuff. I can't wait to get over to the space side and see that. And thanks for stopping by. I really appreciate the company. He and Solo without Heather. Not near as much fun. Now, is this the 105? Age? Yeah, E7. What else do we have in here? The F4. So when my dad was stationed at Hill Air Force Base in Utah, that's where a lot of these were based. And these big old GEJ-79 engines have a howl, a whistle, that you know it's an F-4. And there's the big arresting hook for landing on aircraft carriers. Not on aircraft, that'd be kind of silly. And this thing with the big old hump on it, that's like an AWACS aircraft. Radar. Man, this is amazingly big. Okay. Right under the belly of this thing. Oh, I got a blocked off. The sound of freedom, yeah. Amen, Don, amen. I think on paper, this thing's not supposed to fly. But I guess it's that principle, you cram big enough engines in something, anything's gonna fly. I like that emoji. I haven't seen that one before. That's got a big tail on that thing, doesn't it? Okay, yeah, I'm blocked. And there's a Russian MiG. And another one. Okay, let's go find some presidential airplanes and some space stuff. think there's a shuttle here. Need a golf cart. Oh, they got the right idea. I feel like I'm at Disney. Except I don't hear the beeping. Big quick look. Yeah, I went by it quick, didn't I? If there's something I need to slow down on, let me know. It's just this place is so big, I don't know. It could take hours. That is neat looking. All right. And this is pretty cool. This one has those retractable wings, so once it's up to speed, it could go faster, pull them in. That's where it moves right there. Yep. You know, what's really cool about these B-52s, see how the landing gear has 8 wheels? These things actually, when I'd watch them at Robins Air Force Base take off with my brother at the end of the runway, if the wind was coming at an angle, they'd actually turn the wheels straight down the runway but angle the aircraft. It was crazy to see. It was like coming down like a crab into the wind. How many batteries do I have? I actually didn't come prepared to do that. The batteries in Texas. That's nice though. Appreciate that. You got the time. Another flyer. Let me do this so you can see up here. This room doesn't have nearly the number of aircraft hanging from the ceiling like the other rooms, but good old glory there. Ooh, look at the speaker. They must have to be able to do a massive concert here. Look at those giant speakers. I bet they do some pretty cool shows in here. Oh yeah, look at the giant projector up there behind that at the end of the wing of that airplane. So this is definitely a venue. But it would have to be in front of this giant aircraft. Okay, Cold War Gallery. All right, hopefully it doesn't lag here. Come on, gimbal, behave. Faux brick. Wow, look at this, look at this place. More planes. Still lagging? Shucks. Let me check something. Refresh this. Did that work? Hope that worked. Those hallways are really bad. Without signal. This is a Peacemaker, isn't it? I think so. B-36. It is. That's a funny looking aircraft with the engines pointing towards the rear. Anybody there? I just totally lose the whole stream. Heather, you gone? Well, I'll pretend it's still working. I wish this app gave me than it does. However, it is what it is. It's working. Okay. Thanks, H. Well, Heather, if I just change this W on this airplane back there, it'll be named after you. Well, this is a little bit of a mess. Bad landing. Oh, this is the only remaining XF-90 fighter prototype. It was a test to a nuclear blast in 1952 to see how the explosion would affect aircraft. Well, I'd say the results are pretty apparent. Not good. I'm just walking. And this one has its air brakes deployed. You can see there. So, old aircraft I've flown in. Well, obviously Felix's old air coupe. Yeah, 47, I believe. He had a 46, I think. He didn't make them very long. That's pretty old. About 60, 80 years old. My goodness. Puts it in perspective. Yeah, there's a little Jeep. I miss my Jeep. My old Jeep. Still have the new Jeep. It just puts a smile on your face, and that's how you can tell it's a, even though it has the headlight sticking out, you can tell it's a military one because of the hinges on the bottom of the grille. The CJ doesn't have that. Just that little bit of information nobody really asked for and got anyway. And this one can land in the water. Kind of handy. Oh, this is kind of cool. Took the skin off the side of this to show you what it looks like. Oh, wow. Can you imagine firing off this machine gun, and it's right there next to you? Just a little piece of aluminum separates you and the guns. I bet a little vibration going on there when that happens. Oh, look at the size of this landing gear. Well, I gotta know what that's for. There's the back side of the peacemaker.
But it's just for one visit received. It says specific call for 2 minutes.
That's interesting. That was for the XB-36. But this is pretty tall. I mean, it's up to my chest. It's a big wheel. Very big wheel. Okay. Now that I'm completely lost, let's go. Oh, good. There's a sign. Space Gallery. Let's head that way. Go away, lag monster. No lag monsters. That's a Titan. Where's the Do they have a Mercury? Redstone? Rocket? Because that's what Al Shepard went up, is actually one of these. We have space straight ahead. And the presidential stuff. To the left. Okay, I see where we are. Let's go in the shuttle. Wow. Oh, the Valkyrie. That's what that big white plane is there. Really, I don't think that ever became something they used a lot. It kind of, didn't one catch on fire? Kind of like the, what's it called? The one that flew Concorde. Took me a while. Yeah, Mark.
And things didn't go quite right. The launch vehicle fired too long. It went too high.
We can join Mark's tour if you want. That's Apollo 15's actual capsule. That is neat. Wow, look at what re-entry did to it. Just burned the living heck out of it. And this one. Gemini B. Did I lose everybody? And this is a satellite booster. And there's a satellite on top. Oh, that's pretty neat. Not moving this too fast. So much stuff here. Yeah, look at that. This was gonna be a bomber. Well, didn't come to fruition. Or mass production, whatever you wanna call it. XB-70. The X-1 Bell Aircraft Company broke the sound barrier. Background of innovation and the real one that Chuck Yeager flew is at the Smithsonian. Applied an informed brand of free thinking to perceive ways to compute perils of supersonic flight. SR-71, when Gary Powers was shot down over Russia and captured, creating a big crisis. Interesting contraption over here. The twin propellers. Refresh here. Sorry about that. Little timeout there. Well, I don't, can't say I've seen this before. It must be a concept. I don't know what to make of this. Built in the 80s in great secrecy. It did fly 135 times, it says. It is a different attempt at stealth technology. Now this is pretty cool. Avro car. Hey honey, can you pass me the gum? Sure. Supersonic vertical takeoff. Yeah, it's just a giant blade in the middle of it there. And I guess you control it by directing the air with these louvers. Wow, folks get creative, don't they? That is very interesting. This is called the bull nose, and I think that's a good name for it. It looks like that. Oh yeah, look at this. You see the thrust vectoring that this aircraft has. She direct the blast different directions there. Very neat.
Did you guys see the survival exhibit yet?
No. Okay, let's go to the shuttle. Take a look. Oh, I didn't see the guy hanging in the space, so to speak, up there. Nice. Up here. Oh, it's a good view of all these aircraft they have hanging from the ceiling here. Let's do a quick pan. Oh, look, I guess you can go pretend you're in the Air Force or Army and do an obstacle course down there. Oh, they got parachutes hanging up there. How tall that XB-70 is. Its nose right there. Looks like a bird's nose. Or bill. If they have a nose. Yeah, nostrils, I guess they do have a nose. I digress. Yeah, hopefully we don't have Flag City in here. These solar panels are cool looking. So that'd be an example of payload the shuttle would have taken, I suppose. So I guess this is the crew area. I gotta go higher. Confines there, right up to the window. It's pretty neat. The time it would take to understand all the switches in there. Okay, let's go down through the middle of it. Oh, that gate was locked. Let's turn that off and turn it back on again. There. Okay. Once again, this is the museum at the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base, National Museum of the Air Force. Oh, yeah, so this is the cargo bay, just half of it. Okay, let's go see some presidential aircraft. This gimbal is totally fried. And if y'all can let me know if this thing's working. I haven't seen any text in a while, so the signal could be gone. Appreciate it. If you could let me know. the spacecraft that are going up from SpaceX and what the suits that the crew wears now, those white boots that they have and things like that, compared to this. Of course, this is for going outside the vehicle, which is totally different. Space shuttle crew's suits. I remember seeing them in those orange space suits. Okay. Continuing on. That's a interesting looking propeller engines on this one. Completely enclosed on the front. So this. XC-142. It's kind of like the Osprey. It was a for tilt vertical takeoff. I see. So the whole wing on this aircraft moved. Okay, makes sense. I may have lost the chat thing. Did I lose my chat widget? Nope, it's still there. Okay. All right, the presidential aircraft gallery's right here. And there's an Air Force One. I can't imagine what it takes to polish all that aluminum just on the front of the engine, let alone the whole aircraft. Presidential water. Like a Perrier bottle. Johnson administration. Truman, Rummy scorecard. Johnson and Reagan. The cigarettes. Carter's 79 visit to South Korea. Starbucks, Kennedy administration.
Okay.
Luggage tag, Eisenhower. Okay. Perfume. The book Wolf Ford's in Germany. Nixon's invitation to dinner in China. Reagan's seatbelt. Wow. Obama's playing cards. Trump's lunch menu. Well, let's see. Parisian steak and cheese croissant. No prices. Salad, fruit. George Bush visit to Finland. That's pretty neat stuff. Oh wow. Now this is a Lego. Carlos would love to get his hands on a Lego like this, I bet. That'd take forever. Neat stuff. Neat stuff. Well, we've been going on this for a couple hours now. There's just so much to see. Oh, you can go up here. Well, just gotta do that then. All right, it's gonna get this narrow, it says. So this is kind of like that. You can ride if you can get in this vehicle. Yep, made it. Score. And up we go. Hello, welcome aboard. Thank you. Just a second here.
That's a 6-man crew right there in the cockpit alone.
Flight engineer. They don't have those on airplanes anymore. Most modern airplanes. Cut costs, reduce costs. Oh wow. For the communications room, obviously that would be super important. Lots. This is old technology too. In the kitchen. I do have a microwave in here.
Look at all them switches.
Looks like regular old first class seats. Like they do today. A little more headroom. Telephones on the wall.
Well, that's
just ashtrays.
Plane went in the service. We flew this plane during the time.
You don't see that. Oh, it's just in a narrow walkway. Yeah.
Due to the plexiglass.
Yeah, long bench here. This must be a room. Office. Of some sort. Old school CRT TV. Yeah. Couch, bathroom up there. This would be comfortable. And they all do have seat belts. Kennedy's office is in this area, it says. Oh, that's it. Vice President Johnson was sworn in this area, it says. Yep, I can see that in the background. Boy, you could carry a lot of staffers on this thing. That is comfortable up here, or back here. I'm hitting cobwebs and stuff. I think it's just static electricity building up on my hand. And then more laboratories. Okay. Kennedy's airplane. Pretty neat. Oh, okay. Made it down.
Not me, if I'm president, I'm gonna make them fly me around.
You betcha. All right. And we've got another one. These little aircraft are kind of cool. That's the exit. There's the entrance on the other side. All right. We'll go on this one. This plane misses. But why not? The Independence, okay. Maybe there's a sign that tells me. That's who donates to it, but it doesn't say. Here it is. Okay. Truman. President Truman's. So obviously gonna be a lot older. Definitely different. The control sticks in here. That's cool. Does have a lot of radios again. Accommodation's not quite what we just saw for sure. Lavatory. Ashtray in the lavatory. Oh, this is actually a bed up here. And then you got a card table. A little different than the one we were just in. This is the galley. Kind of a bigger table. Just think, Truman probably sat there. And the back of the aircraft with a lavatory. That gets pretty tight. Spin around here. There we go. Excuse me. Ooh. Okay. I think we'll wrap it up here. It's lunchtime. I gotta get back to Columbus, Ohio.
Patrick, my phone died.
Oh, I gotta get on a Connie Constellation first. Eisenhower's aircraft. These are the planes when it came out TWA used for passenger travel. And I'm getting a little loud with those engines. And it's really hard to see the flight deck, but it's there. Once again, a big radio room. Come on, gimbal. Cooperate. It's a nice area there. Okay. Don't touch the, how can you? There's plexiglass over everything. Don't worry. Galley? Toasters? No microwaves. I don't think those have been invented yet. Okay, so instead of luggage, these are beds. Interesting interior, green. Green and gray. Oh, this kind of curtains over your bed. There's a, now there, now that, Clark, is a projector. This is radio. Neat stuff. That's better than any plain restroom I've used before. Okay. That's this one. Okay, let's get back to the space area here. Yeah, I've only hit like four of the six buildings here today. That's how big it is. I haven't even looked at stuff outside yet. So I think we're gonna wrap up. Go have some lunch. Look at that, sides of a jet engine. It's really cool, though. Just one moving part, really, though. The blade. Very, very, very big blade. Well, thank you all for stopping by today. I really appreciate it. It was good to see you. You know, it's been a while. I think the last stream was probably at the Georgetown Square, maybe Pistons on the Square Day. And before that, Disney in January. And the next I-6. Here. Very, 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 very nice. Not sure why there's a Challenger in here. Didn't stop and read it. Oh, it's in there. Put the Air Force emblem on it. Special Ops Supercar. Showcase Air Force Ingenuity, State Art Technology. And same with the Mustang. And the Air Force Chopper. Did OCC build this one? Yeah, I remember this on TV. It does say Air Force OCC Chopper. Huh. Yeah, I remember when they were making that tank and how hard it was to make that tank. That's funny. Okay.
Where'd they go? Where's your, oh, there they are.
All right, into the lag tunnel. Wow, 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 wow. Good times. Oh, wait, souvenir coin? Yeah. $5 each, all right. I can do this. Let's get a coin. Oh, don't think I can use that. Nope, nope, that's not gonna work. How'd that card come out first? Silly. Paying the bills. All right, which do we want? F-16, P-51, F-15, A-10. All right, old school. We're gonna do P-51. Voila. Let's see what we got there. Nice. And on the back side. Cool. So that is a quick tour of the National Museum of the Air Force. Just go outside, see what it looks like outside. Heather, are you still there? Did you get bored? You think they'll have any planes at the Air Force Museum? Yeah, I think so. These hangars are cool looking, aren't they? It's big. Let me go back here so you can see the building. Man, this is not like Texas, that's for darn sure. Oh, dandelions. Heather, you think we got weeds back home? Imagine what those are gonna do. And there it is. The National Museum, United States Air Force. Of course, you can read that. First two buildings that we went through. All right. That's going to be a wrap. Where's that camera swizzle thingy? There's the camera swizzle thingy. Oh. But it's Ed. Texas Takes. Whoops. I'm going to wrap it up and head back to Columbus. Go get some lunch and then head home next Saturday. Good 19-hour drive. That'll be fun. All right. Thanks for stopping by. Appreciate everyone that was here. The 10 thumbs up means a lot. And we'll see you again. Not sure exactly when, but we'll see you again. It's Ed, Texas Takes, saying take care, everyone.